Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming. This talk will be about our Magnolia 5 app that we are releasing as open source exclusively on the conference. First, a few words on me, not too many. I've got a solid software engineering background, did a lot of Java software development. I had my share of that, I think. In 2010, I joined Aperto, and ever since, I had the opportunity to work on really exciting and demanding Magnolia projects, also with customers like the great guys at MBC in Dubai, which was really a great opportunity. And also, for example, for the Kanton Basel-Stadt, which is the public administration of the city of Basel and the Kanton. This is what Aperto does. Let's go down with a little commercial break. This is Aperto, and does it mention it here? What's interesting about Aperto, what you don't see here, is that we have a large technical department with somewhere around 70 to 100 people working as software developers, system engineers, technical project managers, testers, and also a few front-end guys. And that's interesting about Aperto, that we have this technical competence. So for example, the Kanton Basel-Stadt project was entirely a technical thing because concept and design was made somewhere else. But of course, Aperto has a big concept and design competence as well. These are some of our clients. So far for that. And this is about Aperto's and Magnolia's relationship. I think it's a very good one. And I'm always looking forward to the Magnolia conference coming here and talking to customers again. And it's a long relationship. I joined only in 2010, but Aperto and Magnolia worked together since 2006. And so we're one of the first partners, maybe even the first one, but I'm not sure. We did a lot of Magnolia projects since then, also in those old versions where it was really, I think, a hard time doing Magnolia projects, but Magnolia became a great product. And we contributed also to the standard templating kit, not on the Java level, but on the front-end level, like the HTML, CSS structure, which was great 4 years ago. Aperto contributed that. And, oh yeah, there's the number. About 50 people who are experienced with Magnolia in the whole of the company. And we do quite a bunch of international projects. Not sure we're going to see a slide on that, no? So we got offices in Basel, Zurich, Dubai, Beijing, I'm not sure I forgot something, and Berlin, of course, so we're Berlin-based in the first place. That's where most of the people work. Okay, back to our subject. What are vanity URLs anyway? I wondered myself. So I did a bit of research, and there is a great blog post by Antti Hietala. I don't know how to pronounce the name. It's a great blog post about vanity URLs and how you can configure them in Magnolia. So Magnolia does support vanity URLs, but we will see later on why it's very useful for our customers to have a dedicated app for that. And what are vanity URLs used for? Well, if you show somebody a URL somewhere and he's not able to click or tap it, then you better have a nice and handy short URL that you can easily remember and type in again, and that would be called a vanity URL. This could be a very temporary thing for some campaign that's going on for Christmas sales, and then you've got /Xmas on your site as a vanity URL. So just to differentiate it, it's not just a short URL. Short URLs are short, but very hard to remember and very hard to type in. let alone trying to type this in on your mobile phone. Where's the numbers? Okay, switch to the numbers, switch back to the characters, it has the Y, the I, it will switch back to numbers, and so you don't want to really type this in on your mobile phone, I guess. There's of course better ways to get URLs from the outside world into your mobile phone. We will get back to that later on. But let's get to an example for the moment. You are sitting at a train station waiting for your train, and you can't help but look at that gigantic poster campaign in front of you. And let's take, for example, that let's assume there was some poster campaign from Aperto showing you something about what we did for Canton Basel, and now you're really interested in what Aperto is doing for Canton Baselstadt. And maybe let's assume it's not a poster. We could also think of what could be a good place for a vanity URL could be also be a plane flying with a long flag trailing behind. It's saying Aperto on it and something about our work for Canton Baselstadt. Okay, the question is, which URL would you be more likely to type in on your mobile phone? Because you're on the outside, you've got your mobile phone, you want to know it, I want to know it, I want to type it in. Will you type in that? So that's actually the URL for Aperto's press release concerning our work for Canton Baselstadt. Probably not. That looks better. That's easy to remember, and you can quickly type it in. So that would be a nice vanity URL. Don't try it out. It does not exist. It's just an example. All right. Coming back to getting URLs into your mobile phone, of course, a better way of doing that is QR codes. And well, the drawback of that is that you need to have an app on your mobile phone. As far as I know, no smartphone does it out of the box. So you always have to have an app to scan in the QR code and be able to browse to the URL. You could try it with that one, for example. That's why I put it there. Okay, QR codes. Only the other day I learned via LinkedIn and a posting from Adrian Blum from NBC that there is kind of a dispute going on over QR codes, whether QR codes are a good marketing tool in the digital world. Again, something I learned, that there is this dispute. So that's, according to Adrian Blum, this is the flowchart for deciding on whether you want to use QR codes or not. But talking about, then I searched for the image via Google image search, because it was only the image showing on Adrian Blum's LinkedIn posting. And I think originally it was published in this article on TechCrunch. That's a very interesting article because it does show numbers on, is my mouse somewhere? It does show numbers on QR code usage in China. And, okay, not in here. Anyway, the link is in the slides. If you look it up on the internet, you can have a look and you will see in the article that it's like quadrupling within 2 years or something like that. So doubling every year the usage of QR codes in China. And you may have also seen images of supermarket stores where for each product you have a QR code for the product and people can scan it and use it maybe in South Korea or something. So QR codes, they are really, I think they're popular in the Asian world. And I also think they have their advantages. So, for example, this is the Twitter board of the Magnolia conference, and you will see later on that our vanity URL app can also create QR codes. And so you can use QR codes for Twitter boards to direct traffic to your page by posting an image of the QR code on the Twitter board, so anybody passing by the Twitter board can scan it and go to your website if you want, and if they want, and if anybody notices there is a Twitter board at all, which I'm not so sure at this conference. All right. So there seems to be a need for QR codes in the world, and it wasn't yet directly supported in Magnolia, so we thought we have this vanity URL app, and we also would really need a nice visual feature in the app, so Frank Sommer quickly programmed it there. By the way, Frank Sommer did all the programming of the vanity URL app. It wasn't me. He just lets me do the talking. So vanity URLs, they're a common use case for content editors. You need that if you do online marketing with your websites, and if you're, as a company, big enough to, I don't know, pay poster campaigns or TV campaigns or planes going with a long trailing flag behind it. So we had our customer project where this was a requirement. But you may ask, why an app if Magnolia does support it anyway? If we take a look at that article by Antti Hirtaler, you will see a lot of screenshots of configuration areas in Magnolia. So let's see what the problem is. Okay. There is in blog post, I really would like to show it, just a second. Damn it. Not so easy. Oh, there it is. So, if you want to create a vanity URL, you have to deal with all this. You've got to understand it, and you've got to understand the different kinds of redirects you want to have, because essentially in the end it's a 302 permanent redirect, I think. You can do all kinds of redirects in Magnolia, and you have to deal with the configuration space. So, not so easy and not so obvious, let's put it that way, especially not if you're a... Okay, let's get back to what it is. It's a 301, not 302, I'm not sure. But anyway, our app will do the right redirect for you, because this is the one where search engines will remember that this is that the target is the real page, will serve the real page content for the URL. That's better for your ranking of the page. If you do, you could do in Magnolia, I think it's called a forward, which means that under the same URL, under two different URLs, you would get the same content, which gets you into the duplicate content trouble with Google. You don't want that, because it's bad for your search ranking. And with this redirect, you don't run in that trouble. So that's usually what you want, and that's what our vanity URL app does for you. So what do you have to do? Go to the config workspace and locate your module. Go into the virtual URI mappings in there and enter some configuration code. And well, this is the example from the blog post. Instead of forward, you've got to type in redirect. So easy. I mean, we're on the technical track, so maybe that's easy for you, I can imagine. But not easy for page editors who don't have a technical background. We do have customers where the users of the system, they are essentially journalists, for example, who don't know much about the technical the technicalities of this thing, like what kind of redirect and where to configure it. And they know how to use Word and how to get their content into the system, but they don't and should not know anything about what's going on in the background for vanity URLs. And it can be very dangerous. I don't know if anybody of you ever messed up his Magnolia installation by configuring a bad virtual URI mapping. I did. So it's easy to lock yourself out from the system, even if you think you can do it. And I guess it's really dangerous to let anybody, like page editors, do this. They should not do it. So we got to leave this to experienced web administrators. So no problem. There is the experienced web administrators, the content editors. They just going to ask them, can you create a vanity URL for me? But then some companies have a large workforce of page editors, and they don't want to ask somebody else if they want to create a vanity URL. It's getting in their way of doing their job. It costs time, and maybe the web admin is playing table tennis at the moment or has other things to do. And so we want to get this independent. We want to empower our page editors. We want to disentangle this. The page editors should be able to do the job without the web admins. So there's a reason for the app to exist. Just a second. Okay. There's our app. So page editors will see this one. And here they will see all the vanity URLs that are configured in the system. And you can at one glance see what the target link is. You can see what the vanity URL itself is. I think that's the name column. This is what you will see. Frank, please correct me if I'm wrong. I think the name column is that what you will see at the end of your vanity URL. And in a multi-site Magnolia, you will also have to decide what site the vanity URL should work on. And if you don't have multi-site, then it will take, I think you have to use the default site, which is pre-selected. So let's add a vanity URL. It's really hard to see what you're typing. So the destination, this can be, of course, a page in your system. So you can select any page in the site tree, just as you would expect. And you can also add a link target, like this hash thing here, anchor. I think it's called anchors. And if you're not sure what all this means, you can always click the little question mark. There is a help text coming with all of the attributes. Okay. Where is it? Is it that one? Yep. Okay. And now on your right-hand side, you see all the actions, what you can do with this thing. So you could, for example, preview the target. What it does is open an iframe within your Magnolia 5 and show you the link target. This also works if you have an external link. So actually, we can create vanity URLs for anything. So you have this vanity URL on your system, but it redirects to an external system or one of your other domains or something like that. So in this case, this is actually a redirect to Magnolia. Interesting. Let's preview that one. Works the same. Looks a bit like we're still in Magnolia because colors are the same. Let's take something else. Let's take this one, for example. So this is the web page of one of our companies, Aperto Move, specializing in mobile development. And from here, you can also publish and unpublish your vanity URLs. So if you think this is all right, this should go live, then you can publish it. I think there's lots more features that people can think of that you might want to have here. I will get later on to what anybody could do with these ideas, because this is an open source project and we're going to publish it. We're going to publish it as on the Magnolia Forge. You can see already here that the preview of the QR code. And from here, you can view the QR code. And that's what I took the screenshot of to post on the Twitter board of the conference. So that's another use case. Twitter target Twitter boards with your QR codes. All right. Okay, I put some screenshots here in the slides, so these will end up in the what's it called, slide share, I guess, afterwards. Okay. No, you may say, okay, what's so special about this app? It doesn't look very special. Looks very regular. It looks like a content app from Magnolia 5. And for us, it was a very interesting case to explore a bit outside of customer requirements, to explore a bit the possibilities of the content app framework. And even though it may look a bit boring, I think it's great, because we were able to use the content app framework of Magnolia 5, which is really new. I don't know who of you has already programmed a Magnolia 5 app and did really make their own experiences with the framework, because yeah, that's not so many. It's getting more. It's getting more and more. That's good. So for us, I mean, we're doing a lot of business with Magnolia, and of course it was really exciting to see whether this will work out, the new Magnolia 5 app framework. And I think it does work. So this is our conclusion from this little experiment. I mean, of course, we have to do Magnolia 5 apps for custom requirements, and we use it regularly in our Magnolia 5 projects, but maybe not with things like displaying a custom preview or having a custom column to display and stuff like that. So for us, it looks like the content framework works great. It's got very good concepts, and it allows you to customize the default app that you usually take as a starting point, to customize it on that level that you really want to customize it. So it's got very, very positive aspects. Any user will feel at home because they work with content apps maybe the whole day anyway, so this is just another content app, so they will immediately know how to work with it. So it's not like a big difference. Like, there was another conference talk where you saw the administration interface of an entirely different system being shown within Magnolia 5 as an iframe, and it's so obvious this is something completely different. And even if you use Vadin, you start developing your own user experience concepts. But Magnolia already did that for us, and I think Andreas Weder also did a really great job at this. And for us, it's positive as well, because there is a lot we can reuse. We don't, as developers, we don't have to reinvent the wheel and start each time thinking about how do we display data, content objects to the user, and how do we have CRUD operations, create, retrieve, and update, delete operations. How do we present that to the user? We don't have to worry about that. It's already done for us, and I think it's also touch optimized already. So that's great. I just realized that I don't have my Eclipse running. Okay, so what were the main points we had to configure? What is it that we had to do? Okay, we're getting closer to the code, so this is the time to thank Frank Sommer, who did all the programming and was also really quick to include the QR code feature, for example. So what sub apps do we have in our in the Vanity URL app? We've got the browser that gives you the overview. This is just a standard Magnolia content app browser. And of course, we've got the editor, also very standard. The only thing on this level that is a bit special is the preview, which will show the QR code. So this is what you see in the configuration of the app. So this is a bit our experiences. I thought it would be interesting for others who did not really start developing or don't know so much about the new content app framework. What you have to do, you take some default app, which would be the assets app, because it's got all the features, including resizable images and stuff like image previews and stuff like that. So when you take that, you start by cutting away what you don't need. So for us, any trees or thumbnail previews don't make any sense. What we need is a pure list of what we have in there, like a table. There is no need for a tree here. Also, nobody wants to have thumbnail images of all QR codes and make them larger and smaller. Would be funny to see, but doesn't make any sense. So we just cut away that. And in the end, we're just left with what we need. Next, the first real customization, except for cutting away stuff we don't need, is the QR code generation. How does it work? It happens during save. So when you commit the dialog for your Vanity URL, the QR code is being generated, and the binary is stored in the workspace of the app. So I forgot to mention it, but our app has its own workspace. And it happens in this custom save action. Maybe we can have a look at it. Probably I will have to increase the font size or something. Oh no, it works. I think it's all right. So that's where we store our preview image. This is already the QR code library doing its work. And that's where we create the node and store it. Nothing really very, it's not a big deal to do it. And how does Magnolia then, we're storing the image somewhere. And how does it get into our preview then? How does that work? There is a standard configuration option called original image node name, which is the name of the node where Magnolia will try to get the preview image from. And we just configure it to be the name of our binary node. And Magnolia will happily pick it up there. And there was not much we had to do, I think. Frank, please tell me, is it right? Like, we just have to store that node and then configure Magnolia to pick up the binary there, and that's all. And suddenly you've got your custom preview. So I think that's nice. Now we got our custom field for site selection. So we've got this drop-down, and we somehow have to tell Magnolia where to get the values from, because there is no such field in Magnolia for selecting a site, as far as I know, it seems. So we defined our own site select field. Okay, this is the framework method that we override, where we have to provide our options for the select field. Nodes, where do they come from? Get nodes, okay. Here's our get nodes. And here we are simply querying the nodes in the configuration. So you see here, we're just looking into this path in the configuration and to look up what sites exist there. Probably there is a Java API for doing the same. I guess so. There's probably some site manager class or something like that, but this also works, and it's pretty simple. What else? Okay, how does the actual link evaluation work? Now, this isn't a Magnolia 5 feature anymore. This already existed in Magnolia 4. So there is the standard configuration of custom virtual UI mappings that you might have in your module. We put our own vanity URI mapping there. And what this thing does is it looks up in our custom workspace whether there is anything that matches in combination with the site. What was it called again? Virtual vanity. My neck will ache when I go out of this. There it is. So somewhere. Okay, then we can define some excludes. I think by default we exclude the dangerous URLs or something, like the dot something URLs, so you cannot mess up your Magnolia instance with this. We exclude these kinds of URLs by default. And then we're basically doing a repository query to find whether there is a matching URL. Possibly this could be optimized by caching the configured URLs in memory in a hash map or something like that. So we don't, because this could mean that we have a query on each request, which is not so great. But there's always room for optimization. Maybe one more thing worth mentioning is the custom column. So when you want to have a column that display something entirely computed or retrieved from an external system or whatever, but it's not stored literally in your content, then you have to define your own link column for Matter that does it for you and configure it somewhere. It's a very usual thing in frameworks like that to be able to have your own column for Matter or something. So we just use our vanity. So this is a very, in the end, the code is very small. It's very, very short. Not much to do here. And if you look at this, this is really all the Java code. It's not much, and it's not long classes. So, and also if you look at the configuration, can I turn around this thing? Where's the damn thing? Okay. If we start looking at the configuration, if we start from the bottom, so this is a standard content app. If we start looking from the top, then we see this is all standard Magnolia classes, nothing special. Still standard Magnolia classes. So there is a high level of where you can start customizing the Magnolia classes or subclassing them and replacing them with your own implementations. But it was not necessary at all for us at this level. So we really have to go to dig deeper into the configuration. Then we will start finding our custom classes. Not even that. I think that's all standard, still standard. So there's a lot of levels on which you can customize your app, starting with the Magnolia, within the Magnolia Content App framework. And in our case, it was really somewhere down there in the configuration, where only there we had to customize, which tells me that the overall framework is well done, because we don't have to start with the app class and subclass it and overwrite methods or something like that. We can just take it as it is. And we end up with not so much code for the whole thing. Okay. So, now you may wonder, can you use it? Or where can you get it? And it's open source. And we release it under the GPL version 3, just as Magnolia does release their community edition. And you can find the source code on GitHub. It is part of the Magnolia Forge. We use their infrastructure, but we put the source code on GitHub because it's more inviting for people to fork us there and maybe contribute some bug fixes or customize it to their needs, whatever. For people to get involved with the source code, it's more inviting on GitHub. Maybe at some point Magnolia will use a GitLab, then we will probably move there. So if you want to use it, modify the source code. You can use it for free anyway. If you modify the source code, please fork us on GitHub so we get a hint of what's going on. That would be nice. As for the Magnolia Forge, we do use the Magnolia Jenkins, and it deploys the artifacts to Magnolia Nexus. So if you want to use the module, you have to... wait a minute. You have to, that was the wrong one. Include the Magnolia Forge repository. And on GitHub, you will find details on which Maven artifact to include, and also other useful links. So I invite you to use it, and also I very much invite you to enter enhancement or feature requests. If you have a good idea what the app should do as well, or what it could do better, please tell us. And of course also bug reports, and even better, bug fixes in a fork on GitHub. Do you have any questions at this point?